Today on Outside the Box Reviews, we wrap up Clive Barker Week with the last of the four original Cenobites, and today we're looking at the NECA Hellraiser Wave 2 Butterball Cenobite. And it's really funny, because when I had planned to do a Clive Barker Week within this month, I had not planned to get my hands on the female, and I had not planned to get my hands on Butterball here. I actually had a couple other Hellraiser figures that I wanted to review, but you know what? I would much rather review these guys. And Butterball is, fortunately, not a hard figure to come by. I bought him off Amazon for like $12, so no real increase in price since he was originally on the shelves. Same availability, still prime shipping. Worked out pretty well. Let's take a closer look at him. Butterball comes with his section of the Pillar of Souls, all figures in Wave 2 do. So he got some gruesome little heads on here, naked male torso and a naked female torso, and a little angry head down here. Not much to it, it's a pretty narrow piece. We turn around to the back, we could see it's actually marked which side it goes on. So there's an A here and a B here. And I do believe that the pinhead piece I had has B on it. So those can actually kind of sort of mesh together and exist as at least a corner of the Pillar of Souls. So I can actually now stand this up and have it on display and just show it from an angle, which is kind of cool. Now Butterball's other accessories, I really don't want to mess with too much. They're very small and I'm afraid I'll lose them. He comes with this little pick in his hand. It's clear elastic banded into his hand. I really don't have any intention of taking those bands off anytime soon. Maybe I will, but really, I just don't want to risk losing this little thing because it's so tiny. I really don't know how well he holds it without the clear elastic on. And some of these tools down here are removable. You can pluck him out of his little apron there. And I'm sure maybe if you were so inclined, you could actually stick them in his hand, but once again, they are so tiny. I've never quite been able to tell which one of these are supposed to come out, which aren't, because this is, you know, about a 10-year-old figure, and I think some of the plastic is actually fused together from heat and wear over the years, so a lot of these don't want to come out of my belt. Once again, kind of glad, because that means they'll stay in there a little better, but not really sure which come out, what stay in. They might all be designed to come out, I think, actually, but yeah, I'm not going to mess with them too much. The head sculpt here on Butterball is pretty cool looking. It's got the big folds in the neck. Some great paint detailing on the skin. You can see kind of this purpley streak going through here. It's really nice paint work there. Also some highlights in the flesh. Is the blood dripping out of his ears where the sunglasses go in. The big bulbous nose and blood around his mouth with the sharp little teeth and tongue in there, which is quintessential Butterball, which is really nice that NECA got all those little details into this head sculpt, kind of making it as iconic as possible. You can see the indentations on the side of his head pulling in towards the skull. Here in the back, like the female, he has a chain and a hook coming up, pulling down on his head. This is all one piece on the actual head sculpt, so no real risk of hindering anything like the female's does. But this isn't the only head. We can pull this off, and here we can see the head actually has a very sturdy, very large peg in it, so no real risk of breaking that. That's pretty nice. And then we can bring in the unglasses head. So basically the exact same head sculpt, even the mouth is, if not the same, very similar. I'm pretty sure it's exactly the same though. But then we get the added detail of the eyes being sewn shut. To me, it's much more iconic to have them with the glasses on, but hey, you have this version if you really want it. Same hook in the back of the head, same everything. For the body, he actually has less detailed clothing than the rest of the Cenobites. He has a very plain black tunic thing on. There's some stitching going up the front. He has some shoulder pads that are soft rubber. The back is more ornate, some buckles, some little shoulder area looking things with skin exposed. The more I look at him, the more I realize his costume is very similar to the female Cenobites, and that's kind of interesting. The arms are hard sculpted with the basic level of detail. And then on his hand, none of his fingers are gloved. All the Cenobites have different fingers that are covered or not covered. He just has a strap that goes to around his middle finger, but it doesn't cover any of the fingers. And of course, there is a little blood on his hand. His other hand is a more open pose, and you can actually see where the straps are connecting on there. Pretty cool looking. Here on his stomach, we have the hooks that are ripping apart his stomach. And this is an area of detail I don't really like. The paint detailing on the actual stomach with the flesh tone isn't nearly as nice as the head. It's very flat. The sculpt is there. You can see all the wrinkles in the skin, but very flat paint. Same with this red. It's just a very bright, plain red. They've actually been really good with their use of blood effect in this line, and this is one of the weakest pieces we've ever gotten, I think, blood-wise. Maybe it's just because it's the most in one place we've ever had on one of these Cenobites, at least that I've had. But it looks like it's not a very deep gash, and there's just this very cartoony, lipsticky blood around it. Also, where these hooks come in, there's some blood coming out. Now, on my figure, when I got it, these hooks were all intact. They're all just a plastic hook. But these ones were all cracked down the middle, and this top one actually fell off into two pieces and was the hardest of the bunch to repair. You can see it doesn't really look quite right. And of course, this attaches to the soft rubber of the upper torso sculpt, so it's kind of probably the reason why it's ripped. It's independent, theoretically, little plastic hooks. They're inside the hard plastic of the stomach, connected by a thin little wiry piece of plastic or metal, I can't tell, connected to the soft rubber. So it's all kind of just a lot of mixed materials in there. And of course, still soft rubber stitched onto the bottom of the upper body is the tool belt. Then we have the skirt down here, just like the females, has the purple mesh in it, and it's also kind of billowing in a way that looks like you might be walking or at least stepping forward. And also, just like the females, it's an armature in the middle and the plastic base with the impression of feet on there. For articulation, he could swivel at the head, obviously no up and down. Pin socket shoulders, so forward and back and out to the side, which is better than a lot of the other figures. Swivel at the elbow, swivel at the wrist, and swivel at the waist, which I wasn't expecting. So overall, I really like this figure. He's, once again, a product of his time, less articulation, and some of the detail is a little lacking, but I think overall he came out pretty well, and the fact that he's so readily available makes this one of the easiest things to actually recommend and think you could actually go and get. Chatterer is kind of hard to come by, females really hard to come by, even the pinheads nowadays are pretty hard to come by, but Butterball, you can just hop on Amazon, plunk down your 13, 12 bucks, whatever it is, and have him shipped right to your house. But I think he's solid. He's a representation of the character that he is. He's a very unique body type, which is kind of cool in this line. We have a lot of skinny characters, and he's one of, I think, the only two fatter characters that we got in this entire line. I think Barbie being the other one, which I believe was Wave 1. His Pillar of Souls section is kind of bland, but it's a section of it, so if you're collecting all these figures, you're one step closer to completing it. The biggest gripes I have are, well, basically the construction of the stomach, both the weakness of the chains and the lack of paint detail, and just the fact that I feel like these are really going to be easy accessories to lose. But that wraps up Clive Barker Week. And from here we move into the last week of the horror figure marathon, looking at what I think is the most appropriate thing to look at the last week of October, Michael Myers figures from the Halloween movies. Make sure you check out Outside the Box Reviews on Facebook, there'll be a link below. Also check out Outside the Box Reviews on Instagram, username Outside the Box Reviews. And until next time, make sure you stay tuned through the rest of October as our countdown to Halloween continues.